Hello, welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm Mike Zielinski. I'm honored today to have as my guest Dr. Stephen Mech, who is the Associate Professor of Biology and the Department Chair here at Albright College. And we're here to talk about climate change and global warming. And before we begin, should I call you Dr. Mech or can I call you Steve?
Steve is fine.
Steve. I'd just like to say I totally believe in global warming because here it is in November. My allergies are a mess because we haven't had a killer frost. And one of my biggest questions is if we're going to have true climate change, why can't we get San Diego's weather and they get Redding's weather? It amazes me, Steve, you know, all the things you see on both sides of the equation. And there are educated people out there who are denial of science. But, you know, on one hand, you're saying that, you know, we're never going to reach the ambitious temperature goals adopted by the Paris Agreement. The last 2 years were the warmest on record, and this one looks like it's going to make it three in a row. There's going to be a growing number of climate refugees hit by hunger, poverty, illness, and conflict because of the buildup of CO2 and other greenhouse gases and raising temperatures in the atmosphere. Glaciers and ice sheets are melting. Sea levels are rising. Many parts of the world are experiencing more intense heat waves and droughts. There was one study, it was disputed by some, coming out of a grad student at Stanford, said that this is the warmest Earth has been in 120,000 years, and eventually hitting its hottest mark on mark to hit its hottest mark in more than 2 million years. And we're having more sunny day flooding. And then on the other side, which is unbelievable, and maybe they're right, but that's why you're here to tell us they're not, hopefully. You know, the world has warmed a mere 0.36 degrees Fahrenheit over the last 36 years. And amazingly enough, they haven't seen any global warming for 17 years. And that they actually say the North Polar ice cap is increasing in size. Now, I've seen some of those glaciers, and I've been in helicopters where they tell you they're shrinking. And you know, and they have a lot of, so what gives, man? I mean, I believe in climate change and global warming.
Oh, absolutely. And I have to say that, first of all, it's not, well, first of all, thank you for having me here, but it's not just global warming and belief or not. It's a lot of it has to do with whether or not you trust the scientific data.
Yes.
And there's also a confusion between weather and climate. Weather is the day-to-day changes. Like today we have warm weather for this time of year.
Yeah.
But the climate is the long-term average. And so if you look at the long-term average, the average change is increasing. So the average temperatures are increasing over in any almost any particular area, particularly in the northern hemisphere. And so that is, the scientific data is very clear on that. If you look at the NASA data, the NOAA data, the individual weather stations, you look at plots at weather.com or whatever, there are definite increases in the average temperature over the last 5, 10, 15 years. And so while any 1 year may be high or low, it's the long-term average that really concerns the scientists in terms of global climate change.
Now, global climate change can be historical and cyclical, correct? Mm-hmm. And have nothing to do with man's emissions.
Right.
But is mankind making the historic cycle worse?
Absolutely. And the historic cycle is on the order of millennia, so thousands of years, where we see these changes in temperatures.
Because I understand at one time, North America was a very inhospitable place to live.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
Nobody lived here then.
But yeah. But even if you go back to you know, the last ice age. Last ice age, we were at about a degree and a half to 2 degrees cooler than it is now. And on average, globally. Locally, in North America, we were about 8 degrees cooler.
Wow.
And so it really depends on where you are and whether you're looking at global average or a local average. And it was much warmer before the ice ages, so back, you know, several hundred thousand or millions of years ago. And so there is a cycle there, and that has to do with the orbit of the Earth. But those changes occur on the order of tens to hundreds of thousands of years. where you change a degree or, you know, 1 to 5 degrees centigrade. I'm talking centigrade. As a scientist, I understand.
You guys do that just to confuse us.
But 1 to 5 degrees change is a fairly large change. And that happens on the order of tens to hundreds of thousands of years if you look at the geologic record. We're looking at a 0.85 degree change on average since 1900 to now.
And that's because of the Industrial Revolution?
Because of the increase in carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide acts as a greenhouse gas. The greenhouse gases trap heat within our atmosphere. Now, we need some greenhouse effect. Otherwise, the Earth, if we had no greenhouse effect, the Earth would be on average 33 degrees cooler than it is now. And so we'd be one big ball of ice, inhospitable. So we need some greenhouse gas. But the difference is the greenhouse gases have increased to the point where they're trapping more and more Earth, or more and more energy, close to the Earth, which is increasing the average temperature. Carbon dioxide is the primary one because we emit more carbon dioxide than anything else. But methane is also very important. Methane is actually much more potent than carbon dioxide. But the carbon dioxide and methane is trapping more energy, and therefore we are increasing the temperature. And the emissions of carbon dioxide have been tied, or the anthropogenic emissions have been tied to the drastic increase. They've done models predicting natural increase versus the anthropogenic increase, and the only one that fits actual temperature changes across the globe over the last 150 years is if you include that anthropogenic change, those carbon emissions caused by humans, human activity.
Do you think the people, I have several questions, do you think the people who are science deniers in this regard basically don't trust the data because they have the viewpoint that is bad for the economy?
I do. In my cynical view, I would say yes, it is very self-centered.
Because the science usually isn't disputed that much in most other areas, right?
Right. But if you look at the tobacco companies, they were saying that tobacco doesn't cause cancer. Good. And they said that for years, and then it came out, and we found evidence that they knew that it caused cancer, and they were essentially lying to the public.
Yes.
Leaks have shown that ExxonMobil knew and argued in the 1970s that fossil fuels will cause global climate change, and then they buried the data. And so I think it is very similar to the tobacco industry hiding the data to protect their own interests. I think the oil companies are doing the same thing. That's my cynical view. I admit that that's a cynical view, but they've shown that they've found some of these articles.
Did it hurt, I believe Al Gore, who was one of the early proponents, former vice president, was talking about global warming, and apparently he may have said some things that indicated that it would be worse at this point than it is, so people have said, oh, see, he didn't know what he was talking about, he's exaggerating.
Absolutely, and that's a common flaw in any of these types of arguments where the scientists, politicians, advocates, whomever, makes these arguments to draw attention to it.
They might overstate it.
And they speak in hyperbole to get people's attention.
And it undercuts their credibility.
Right, and it does destroy their credibility.
We have had, I think, and maybe from my perspective, in North America, United States, we've had more severe weather, I think, in recent years than I remember. Is that in any way... because I know climate change and weather, as you put it out, are two different things. But is it riding it to a degree in tandem?
Absolutely. The with the increased energy in the atmosphere, we can expect more severe storms, more frequent storms, and more unpredictable storms. And so those types of things, and this goes not just for the hurricanes and things, but also heat waves, rains, floods, things like that, absolutely can be tied to the increased amount of energy in the atmosphere. One of the major things that's tied to global climate change is the rise of the sea level. Most people think of that as due to the melting ice caps. That does add to it, but that doesn't add nearly as much as the increased temperature. The ocean actually absorbs quite a bit of temperature, quite a bit of heat energy. As things get hot, they expand. And so the ocean is expanding due to the absorption of heat. So it's a good thing that it's expanding in that it's absorbing much of the heat that would otherwise be in our atmosphere. but that causes the sea level to rise and causes flooding.
Now, how dire of a problem is that? Because they say the tentacles of the problem reach far beyond environmental to the realms of politics, society, and national security, as even naval bases are in danger. Mm-hmm. And I know there are certain signs of certain areas where communities are trying to spend money to at least abate the problem a little bit as the sea brim rises. Mm-hmm. And it just apparently just takes a high tide and a brisk wind to cause a lot of issues. In Congress, they're nowhere near to spend the tens of billion dollars needed just to catch up to the current flooding problems, much less get ahead of them. How close are we to the critical point where it's beyond the point of return?
I think we are very close.
It sounds like we're just going to let that happen.
Well, I think there are many people that are working hard to help alleviate it as much as they can. But there's a huge momentum. So there's two things here. One, for example, Miami is investing millions of dollars in raising certain streets and working on saltwater pumps to get the pump to mm-hmm. pump the water out, because at high tide they have streets that flood just because of high tide. Mm-hmm. And so they're working on very large infrastructure investments just to prevent that flooding. And as you may or may not know, the governor of Florida has made it made a policy that no one can mention global climate change.
He's a denier.
Right.
I mean, he's the governor of that state.
Right. But the mayor of Miami is very much a climate change advocate.
Yeah.
And so he's making this investment based on just the taxes from Miami. And they're struggling to pay for it, but he recognizes, and the people of Miami recognize, that it has to be done. Getting to your point about are we past the tipping point, the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is above 400 ppm, parts per million. And it just topped that 400 parts per million in the last year. The last time it was that high was more than 1.5 million years ago.
Jeez.
And it has not been above 350 parts per million in the last 400,000 years, where we have very good records. And so the estimate of 1.5 million years is an estimate based on some more problematic data.
Now, is it just restricted to Florida, or is it the whole East Coast? I mean, Carolina Beaches, Jersey, Manhattan?
Yeah, the flooding is going to occur all up and down the East Coast. But Miami is one of the lowest cities, major metropolitan areas in the nation.
Because I know Jersey, sure, some places, like if it just rains hard, mm-hmm. you got a lot of water in the streets.
Right,
you know?
And you think of like Hurricane Sandy and it washing away the dunes.
Yeah.
One of the reasons it was so effective at that was, yes, the power of the storm, but also because the average tide was so much higher.
How about Manhattan? What's the problem?
I think Manhattan is going to see many more problems with flooding of the tunnels. They're actually working on building a new subway tunnel. Some of the subway tunnels that flooded are because of the corrosion and such. I think if you go on to the, I think it's one of the NOAA websites, they have videos that you can click on and watch flooding in major metropolitan areas, and Manhattan's one of them. And they have a slider at the bottom where you can adjust it for 1, 2, 3, 4 meters of change.
People should really be frightened.
Oh, absolutely. Most scientists predict a minimum of 1 meter of change in the average sea level in the next 100 years that we cannot fix. So that's a minimum. 1 meter of sea level change may not sound like a lot, but if you run that simulation, and like I did it for my class actually a couple days ago in conservation biology, we did it for New Jersey, where a lot of them are from, and some parts of New Jersey get flooded, some cities, but the cities actually aren't nearly as impacted as things like the highways between the cities.
Okay.
We get entire highways that go underwater with as little as 1.5 meters of flooding. And think about the problems we have in the infrastructure right now as is. Now, add on top of that,
our infrastructure is a mess.
Right.
Yeah, you know, especially in the older areas.
Exactly.
Here in the Northeast.
Exactly.
Let me ask you this. I have two questions. Does this also mean the Gulf Coast, like New Orleans, mm-hmm. and parts of Mississippi, and the West Coast?
Yep, absolutely. And now the West Coast is a little bit different because, on average, they're a little bit higher because the Rocky Mountains and the Sierra Nevadas are right there.
Okay.
And those are much newer mountains, and so they're higher in elevation.
So even the beach areas are?
Beach areas are still going to get hit, but the slope is a lot steeper.
Okay.
But there's definitely going to be issues there.
Now, you referenced the 100 years. Mm-hmm. Maybe some of our young grandchildren have a shot of being here then. But what about, what's the danger 20, 25 years from now?
Well, again, it's going to be these increased frequencies of storms and increased impacts of the storms. The storms are going to get bigger, and they're going to come more frequently. And think about the flooding that's happened in Louisiana this year. And that is most
horrific.
Likely.
Meanwhile, California was dying for
right.
a drop of water.
And is. And actually, California, one of the problems with California, not only are they in a major drought, but they're pumping a lot of water to feed the all the agriculture there. And they're pumping so much water that California is actually sinking at a detectable rate each year because of all the water they're pumping
really?
Out of the bottom.
If they get another earthquake, that's not going to help either.
Right. And so these things are all tied together in terms of what we are doing to the environment as a whole.
Yeah, I mean, I just saw in the news the other day, I guess they had China's a mess. Mm-hmm. And apparently, even though the Obama administration was big with the Paris Agreement mm-hmm. on global warming, we're the world's number two polluter.
Oh, absolutely.
But China's a mess. They apparently had to close highways the other day, and apparently that happens not so infrequently because you can't see.
Absolutely. But China, the populace of China is much more proactive at moving towards a green infrastructure.
Oh, they are.
The rate at which they are instituting green infrastructure is far surpassing the U.S. And so if they continue on that trajectory, they will go to green energy with wind and solar energy and become much less reliant on carbon energy and surpass. Then they'll surpass us, and we will become once again the largest polluter.
What about India and Asia? Because some of they have growing, economies.
Absolutely, the growing economies are. That's one of the big arguments with things like the Paris Agreement, is how do we justify the more mature economies saying you cannot pollute? We did that already, and
yeah, right.
But you can't. And so part of that is a lot of these growing economies are trying to work towards more green infrastructure from the beginning. And so renewable energies and things like that. One of the things, even if you're not going to wind or solar, if you're at least using renewable energy such as biofuels, you're taking carbon out of the atmosphere at approximately the same rate as you're returning it, if you can engineer biofuels so that they don't use fossil fuels to be generated.
But global emissions, according to what I read anyway, and you can mm-hmm. just tell me I'm wrong, but they've been increasing every year. Now, the latest numbers I saw was 2014 was reaching 52.7 billion tons.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess annual emissions cannot, according to the Paris Agreement, cannot exceed 42 billion tons of CO2 by 2030 for the world to have a chance to meet their 3.6 degree Fahrenheit heat goal.
Mm-hmm.
But even with the Paris pledged reductions, which apparently not everybody's up to speed on them anyway, instead of 42, it's going to be like 54 to 56 billion tons in 2030, mm-hmm. Which would leave the world on a path of about 5 degrees of warming.
Right.
So how is that going to be cut, those global emissions, realistically?
Well, and that's one of the major issues. We have to educate people on how to cut their own emissions and how to convince their politicians and governments, et cetera, to actually start enacting these policies and procedures to look for solutions. Washington State is trying to pass a carbon tax. And it's a fairly progressive carbon tax in that it's scheduled to be one of the highest carbon taxes in the world. But it's a revenue neutral proposal. So it's offset completely by income tax reductions. So the government is not going to get any additional money.
Really? I like that idea.
The way it's proposed right now. And the economists who wrote that argued that is the most logical way and most likely way to get it passed. So get it voted in. And it's a ballot measure on this year's ballot.
They seem to be a little bit more progressive out west. I mean, good luck having that happen in Texas or Alabama or Mississippi.
Right,
here's
the kicker. The environmental groups are fighting against it.
They are?
Because they want money to come in to combat other social environmental issues. because the environmental changes are affecting a lot of social groups that are historically underprivileged, or minority groups that the mm-hmm. majorities have harmed. And so their argument is we need to increase funds so that we can undo the historic damage that we've done to these groups. And if it's revenue neutral, we can't do that. And so they actually argued against it. And so the latest poll I heard a few days ago suggested that it's not likely to pass, and we'll have to wait and see what the outcome of the election is.
What else is going on here that, you know, because you have a chance to be an advocate here, because most of us don't really know
right.
the details.
And I guess my biggest thing that I would suggest is that you go online and you, the National Geographic Channel just put out a movie, a documentary that Leonardo DiCaprio was in. And Leonardo DiCaprio was the spokesman for global climate change for the UN. And it's an excellent documentary, and it's free online. You can watch it on YouTube or Amazon, or I think it's on Hulu as well. And it's called Before the Flood. And it's an excellent documentary that discusses what we know, what we can do to fix it, how far we've gone, and things like that. Now, it ends just as the Paris Climate Agreement was approved. So before the U.S. signed on, but just at the end of the Paris Climate meetings. And so that's when the movie ends. But it still gives you a lot of really good background. And it should. I think it's much more forceful and much more articulate than I could ever be.
Until governments, though, I think get their feet put to the fire and really make it a national priority. And I'm not sure, you know, hopefully that happens, but do you think it will?
It's going to have to. And I think what'll take is many more people seeing the environmental damage. I mean, if you think about it, most people, and for very good reasons, are much more worried about their own economy, their own health, their own, you know, family.
People are very self-focused.
And
they have to be.
Right.
I
think to a large extent that's justified. But so until they see it start hitting their family or their relatives or their friends, it doesn't become nearly as important.
But when we hit that point, it's too late.
Right. And that's the thing. And that's why people have to become educated about what the science really says. And when they say there's controversy in the scientific community, there's always controversy in the scientific community. The question is, how much of a controversy is it? When 97% of the climate scientists, the people who study climate for a living, agree that climate change is real and it's anthropogenically caused, how can you say that that's really...
I know. It's astonishing. And you know what's even more astonishing? When I was going on my way to look up cons mm-hmm. for people saying it's a crock or a fraud, one of them actually said 99% of scientists dispute the data and don't believe in global warming. I mean, the thing online and the internet, nothing is really, you don't have to prove anything.
Right.
Just say.
And that's where it really becomes an issue. Are you questioning the science and the data, or are you questioning authority? And there's a slight difference there. It's a subtle but important difference. If you're questioning authority, that's one thing. If you're questioning the science, the facts, that's very different. It's like the quip, you're entitled to your own opinion, but not your own facts.
Well, that's the world. Sure. Other than the industrial component of it, for the residential one, does that mean people shouldn't drive like gas guzzlers and SUVs?
Absolutely.
Everybody should have a smart car?
Well,
a hybrid car?
Right, ideally yes, but you have to think about your standard of living and what's happening with you. If, for example, if you look at, you can do your carbon footprint online. If you just Google carbon footprint, you can actually enter in your lifestyle, and it tells you how many Earths it would take if everyone on Earth lived the same way you do. And I'll tell you right now, the fact that we live in America, that by default starts us off at 3.5 globes.
What the, besides... Besides, it's not funny. Why are we laughing? But besides, the gas guzzlers, the SUVs,
right.
What do Americans do that they shouldn't be doing, the average American?
Well, little things like eating Nutella, for example, or any of those chocolate-type spreads. Those are held together primarily by palm oil. Palm oil comes from palm plantations, which is a major source of deforestation in the tropics. And those palm plantations, the palm oil is actually used in a whole lot of different foods. Yeah. And that's a major cause of the cutting down of the tropical rainforests, which causes increase in carbon emissions due to the plants not being there and all sorts of cascading effects.
What was the chocolate again?
Nutella is the one that I pick on, but that's not the only one.
Okay.
It's palm oil. If you look at the ingredients on almost any food that's mass produced, you will see palm oil as an ingredient.
Wow. Now that'd take a long time to change. We only have a couple minutes left. What else?
Use mass transit. Use bike to work.
And that seems to be getting more popular.
Oh, absolutely. Carpool, at least.
Yeah. People don't like to do that unless they're in a metropolitan area.
Right. Look into getting solar panels for your house. You can actually get, many companies will actually pay for the solar panels on your house and then you rent them. And the cost may not be any different. And it may actually be less than getting electricity from the grid.
Yeah.
And, little things like that, if the more and more people that do them, the better off we'll be.
What about the guy who says, well, I'm just one person. Let me do all this and it's in the big picture, it's not going to do anything.
If you have that attitude, no, it won't do anything. But every little step helps. One person has to start. It has to start somewhere.
We have about a minute left, but the scientific community, folks like you, there seems like you have to really be advocates to educate the rest of us idiots that this is a big deal,
You do, but there's actually a debate within the scientific community about should we let the science speak for itself or should we be advocates?
It's not going to speak for itself loud enough.
And that's just it. Most people can't get to the science or don't want to get to the science. So I strongly believe we need to be advocates. We need to go out and reach out to the public and talk to them and explain to them why it occurs. I have neighbors that talk about, global warming can't be happening because there's 3 feet of snow on the ground. Last winter when we had the big snowstorms.
Yeah.
And I would actually stop and take the time and try to explain to them the difference between weather and climate change. And the reason we have 3 feet on the ground is because of global climate change.
Yeah, and all the moisture in the air.
Right.
That's a good point because everybody always brings that up. Well, it still snows a ton.
Right.
Anyway, we're out of time. And I thank you for joining us in at least in this 30-minute blot. Being a tremendous advocate. So be aware, people, and be smart. Take care.